I've tried another bunch of really hyped up Korean skincare products with rave reviews. Some of these are super popular on Reddit and social media. Some are products a lot of you have asked me to talk about. I'm Michelle, I'm a chemist and skincare nerd. All the products I'm talking about today are available on Stylevana, who sponsored this video. They have lots of affordable products from Asian brands. Make sure the products are in stock if you want your parcel to come quickly. This is my discount code. Let me know in the comments if you've tried these products and what other products I should try. Let's start with the Beauty of Joseon Relieve Sun Aqua Fresh Rice and B5. This is a Korean sunscreen. It's not approved in a lot of other countries like the US or Australia. Beauty of Joseon does have some US only sunscreens, so make sure you check the name and the ingredients to work out which sunscreen you're getting. Now, their original sunscreen, that's the Relieve Sun Rice and Probiotics. This is one of my favorite Korean sunscreens. You can probably tell from how dented and gross the tube is. I've raved about it so many times, I actually gave out little samples of this at my wedding. A lot of you have also asked me what I thought about this sunscreen, the Aqua Fresh. It is a newer launch and the idea is very similar. So I'm going to go through some of the similarities and differences between the two. The overall concept is the same. They're both SPF 50 plus and PA with 4 pluses. They are both really lightweight and they use a lot of newer UV filters. The biggest differences, number one, the Aqua Fresh is lighter. It's designed for normal to oily skin. My skin is normal to oily, but sometimes it does get a bit dry, especially in winter. And honestly, the old formula was really good for me. It was really glowy and I really enjoyed that. But I know some people did feel that was too heavy or glowy, especially in summer. This version has more of a matte finish. It has less of a shiny emollient oil layer left on the skin. So this one, much more lightweight, and it's especially obvious when you put it on your face. It's not super obvious when you try it like on the back of your hand. The second biggest difference is that this version does not have MBBT, that's also called Tinosorb M, and it's one of the few newer organic or chemical filters that does come in particles, so it does give a bit of a white cast if you have darker skin. This does use newer filters, but it uses a different set of them to get that same protection. They took out the MBBT and replaced it with a bunch of other things. MBBT is in a lot of Korean sunscreens, so if that white cast was a bit of a problem for you, this one doesn't have it. Highly recommend trying it out. Now, the third big difference is that this does not have niacinamide. Now, I love niacinamide, but some people do have issues with it. Their skin might break out or go red with it. This does not have it. And this is really rare for Korean sunscreens because of how Korean regulations work. There are lots of products that add niacinamide and adenosine because that means that you get that into a special category of functional cosmetics. You can make claims about how it brightens and is anti-wrinkling. So within Korea, this is a really good way of marketing your product as more effective, but most people outside of Korea do not notice this difference in category at all. So overall, this formula just solves a lot of problems that people had with Korean sunscreens. And sometimes I do see people say Beauty of Joseon isn't like real Korean skincare because it is more popular overseas than in Korea. It caters more to an overseas market. And in this case, I really don't think it's a bad thing because white cast and niacinamide, these are rising concerns outside of Korea, so we got our wish. The only real downsides, that lightweight texture, which is great from a sensory point of view, it feels really nice on skin. It might mean that it comes off more easily with things like sweat and movement, so this is definitely not something you want to wear while gardening or exercising. The other big downside, I think, is a change in the packaging. It's not that big of a downside, but I am going to get my packaging expert Omar to come on and talk about the packaging near the end of the video. The next product is the APLB Glutathione Niacinamide Body Wash. This is a new brand for me. It's very no frills. It's almost like a cream version of The Ordinary. And it is a body wash. I haven't tried that many body washes from Korean brands, but I have been looking for something that wasn't too stripping for winter, but I wanted something more exciting than like the standard pharmacy brands. I wanted something that still had some actives. This has 5%-ish of various actives combined. It's got like centella water, niacinamide, glutathione, and it has a patented mix of plant extracts. I'm not sure if they're really doing that much in this cleanser. They claim to have a wide spreading texture system, which gives better skin adhesion and absorption, but it is the same system that they use in their moisturizer. And I didn't see any sort of clinical testing specifically for the cleanser. But it doesn't matter that much to me, to be honest. I'm generally not looking for something super active in a body wash. I didn't really notice any real changes in my skin while I was using it, except this is extremely gentle, it's not irritating, and it is fragrance-free, which is kind of rare for body washes. This is not unscented though. It does have like a fragrance-free smell about it. Like it's that common smell you get from fragrance-free cleansers. And it is in a handy pump bottle, which I really liked. I really enjoyed this product. Next is the Pungkang Yule Calming Moisture Repair Balm. I've reviewed this before and I kind of forgot about it. A friend mentioned to me that she was using it, so I revisited this and it is still amazing. It is one of my top repair products. PKY, I think, is just such an underrated brand. They have so many really solid products. This is a really nice soothing balm. I really love it for when my skin is just grumpy and irritated and can't really handle that much. One of the really cool things about this is from a formulation point of view, when you're putting it on, when it's in the jar, when you're taking it out, it feels almost like a balm in thickness. But then when you put it on your skin, it is actually really, really lightweight. Even compared to like a Western lotion for oily skin, it just feels more lightweight than that. It is really good at sinking into skin quickly. It still ends up matte and not greasy. There just really isn't that much oil in this compared to what you would expect from a proper balm. I'm really used to repair products being thick and greasy and oily, but this is just so light. It actually doesn't make my makeup slide around much at all, which is so good for using during the day. The main oil in this is squalane, which is really lightweight. It is similar to skin oil. And then the rest of the moisturizing ingredients are mostly humectants. These are ingredients that hold onto water and they're generally not very oily, they're more dewy. It has things like glycerin, betaine, trehalose, hyaluronic acid of different sizes. It also contains soothing actives, which are mostly plant extracts, things like centella. But on top of that, it's also got antioxidants, it's got panthenol, which is vitamin B5, and peptides. This balm just works so well for calming and protection when my skin is really irritated and red and chafed. It really helps support it while it's healing without irritating it. And on top of that, sometimes you get those like dry, hard skin flakes when your skin is really irritated. This is really good for softening it. Another thing I really love about this, I'm sorry, I am just like raving about it because it is really good. It glides on really nicely. It doesn't really tug on skin, which sometimes when your skin is irritated, everything hurts, and this just helps cut down on that a bit. I also used this all over my face as like an overnight mask when my skin was really dehydrated in winter. But yeah, absolutely love this. It is such a gem of a product. I feel it is super underrated and I think more people need to know about it. Next up, we have the Make Prem Low Irritant and Mild Acid Foam Cleanser. I heard so much about this cleanser before I tried it. It's won a whole bunch of Korean skincare awards. It is a bestseller in Korea. I saw lots of people raving about it on Reddit. And if you're into like old school Asian skincare blogs, Snow White and the Asian Pear had a big rave about this as well. This is a relatively gentle cleanser and I feel like some gentle cleansers don't quite work well enough. I feel like, of course, they are going to be gentle if they're not doing much. So you are looking for a bit of a balance with that. And I think this is really good for most people. This is really nice. It's got a low acidic pH of 5.5, which is close to skin's pH. And one unusual thing about this is that it makes lots of really luxurious dense foam. A lot of Korean cleansers that do have a nice foam rely on soap surfactants, which are higher pH, and they're skinny so they can burrow into skin and disturb it for longer. This contains a bunch of alternatives that have larger structures like sodium cocal isothionate, sodium methyl cocal taurate, cocoa betaine, potassium cocal glycinate. These ones have bigger structures so they don't burrow as much, but that combination seems to give a really nice foam. This also has lots of moisturizing ingredients like glycerin. It's also got betaine and panthenol, which are like their star ingredients, and hyaluronic acid. All of these are really good humectants, so they keep your skin hydrated and not too stripped during the cleansing process. This also has a lot of antioxidant plant extracts as well, which help to reduce irritation during cleansing. So after this rinses off, I found that my skin felt really nice and soft and hydrated, but it still cleans really well for me as a second cleanser. I find that this is really similar to that Skin 104 cleanser that my husband Omar really loves. And one interesting thing about this is it does claim that it doesn't sting eyes, so I tried it on my eyes and it's fine. It doesn't sting them. So this is great as a second cleanser if you want something that you can use in the eye area. This does have a herbal scent. To me, it smells a lot like rosemary. I wouldn't say it's like super strong. It's sort of on like the moderate side. It's maybe strong for a Korean product, but compared to Western products, it is very mild. Another very specific thing that I really like about this is also the texture. It comes out as like a bit of a hard paste, so it's actually very easy to dispense the right amount that you want to use. It doesn't all just spill out. So yeah, overall, great cleanser. I can see why everyone loves it so much. It is just a really solid cleanser for most people's routines. Next is the K-Secret Sol 1988 Eye Cream, Retinal Liposome 4% and Fermented Bean. The Olympics were held in Seoul in 1988, and that's what this particular line is meant to capture, like the spirit of the times, but it kind of reminds me of that like meme where they say, if you remember this, it's time for an eye cream, and I do feel a little bit called out because that is very, very close to my year of birth. Anyway, vitamin A derivatives like retinal are kind of like the powerhouse ingredients in skincare. They work for lots of skin concerns and they have good evidence to back them up. Retinol with the OL at the end was the most popular one, but retinal with AL at the end, this has become like the more popular one, I think. It's really boomed in the last few years. A lot of brands say retinal is more powerful, which is kind of true, but it also depends a lot on the product. Like the concentration tends to be much lower in retinal products. So I think overall it ends up probably somewhere in the same ballpark. The reason retinal is meant to be stronger is because your skin has to convert retinal to retinal and then to retinoic acid, which is the active form. The reason this wasn't used as much is because it was harder to stabilize, but it is a lot more common in products now. I see it all the time. And in this version, it is stabilized with liposomes. These are sort of like popping boba. The liposome is like a shell. As well as being more stable while it's in the tube, the liposome should mean that it releases more slowly, so it should be gentler, and it helps it get into skin a bit better. In general, I have found that retinal products do feel gentler on my skin, less spicy, and I think it is because these stabilizing methods do make them release more slowly. This one has been through an irritation test, and it's also been combined with antioxidant extracts and ferments, which should help a bit with that irritation. As well as retinal, it does have other actives. It has niacinamide and adenosine, which is like a classic Korean combination for anti-wrinkling and brightening claims. There's also 3-O-ethyl ascorbic acid, which is a stabilized form of vitamin C. There's bakuchiol, and there are a bunch of peptides. Now this does say 4% retinal liposome, and that should convert to 0.04% retinal itself, which sounds low, but it is still pretty powerful. Overall, the formula is very similar to the Beauty of Joseon retinal eye cream. That one has 2% liposome of retinal, so this one is like a stronger version. And both of these are designed to be eye creams. They are mostly tested for fine lines around the eyes, but you can use them all over your face and you don't really need to use that much. So this is like a good size. In my opinion, this is a really good product if you are more experienced with retinoids or if your skin is just really not sensitive to them. This could even be a starter product. If you're introducing a retinoid to your routine, I'd highly recommend adding it to your routine slowly. For example, use it twice a week at night at first and then slowly ramp up. I'd also recommend using it on dry skin and using it with moisturizer and getting rid of any irritating products in your routine while you're starting on it. If your skin is a bit more sensitive or you're very new to retinoids, I'd recommend their other versions first. They have a 1% and a 2%, which also use liposomal retinal. Another thing I really appreciate about this is that it has a nice nozzle that makes it very easy to control how much you're dispensing. I have a problem where if too much comes out, I feel like I need to use it all, but this nozzle just makes it so easy to control how much actually gets dispensed. It really cuts down on the risk of like having a super inflamed face 2 days after you've tried a retinal. Next is the Celimax Derma-Nature Fresh Blackhead Jojoba Cleansing Oil. I really love cleansing balms and cleansing oils. I love just putting it on my face before I step into the shower and just smooshing up all my makeup. It's just so satisfying and so relaxing. I generally prefer cleansing balms because they are easier to control because they're like more solid, but this winter I've used a lot more cleansing oils because in winter, when it's cold, the balms are just harder to spread, and these ones you don't have to work so hard to get them into a liquid. I really love using them as a first cleanser. I mess up my face and then I go into the shower and rinse it off and then follow up with a foaming cleanser. I think I first heard about this one from Bonnie Garner. She runs a website called Beauty Alley and she's raved about this. She's used up multiple bottles. And for me, this really lived up to the hype. It is a really lightweight cleansing oil. It spreads really easily and it also rinses off really easily too. With cleansing oils and balms, this isn't a complete deal breaker for me, but some of them do sting your eyes a bit and they can make your eyes blurry after you've rinsed it off. I tend to remove eye makeup with a Too Faced remover anyway, but sometimes I can't be bothered, I just want the one product to just get my whole face clean. This works really well, there's no eye sting or blurriness for me, and it gets off all my waterproof eyeliner. With the blackhead part, if you massage this into your skin for a longer time, you can kind of pop out little blackheads and clogs. I personally haven't tried that yet, I haven't had that many blackheads recently, but this hasn't broken me out and I feel like this would work really well for that. It also has an extremely light scent, which I like, and the pump is super convenient. I measured this out and it should last about 120 uses for me. Again, a really solid product as a first cleanser, really good for makeup removal. I have zero complaints about this. Okay, so I want to show you some examples of packaging since you are a packaging connoisseur. Okay. You are the in-house packaging expert.
Sure.
Okay. These two tubes. This one is obviously used to death, but what do you think?
Let's start with this one, which is being used more. So, cool, spinning top, little stabby thing there, which is sure, okay.
Squeeze them out, like try them out.
No.
What?
I don't know. What is this even?
Sunscreen.
I don't even know what. Sunscreen. Things we do for science. Omar's official opinion on this is that the short and stub is annoying to place specifically on your skin. It just feels a lot more messy if you use this, whereas this is clean. You know, this, look at this. Actually, if you see there's like actual sunscreen on the threads of this versus here where the threads are completely clean. So this is always going to have an easier time unscrewing. Both of them are twist tops, which I like.
The other difference I would say is that this one is smooth, but this one is ridged. So I think this one does have a bit more grip. I think if they put a ridged lid on this, it would be ideal. This one, what did you think of this pump? You've used it.
No, it's good. No, I actually liked it. It was very easy to use. I could easily squeeze it out. Very utilitarian. So it's good pump top. Omar approves. This is actually good for showers because this way, you know, you can just pick it up, flip open the top. This is a very easy flipper. So you can easily flip it up, open with one thumb if you're like doing any things one-handed. But I would never put this in my backpack because, you know, if I squeeze it. Yeah, see? See? For bathroom use, yes. Packaging approved. For backpack or travel use, no. This is not enough. This needs to be a full twist-off cap.
This one. It's a cream where you have to use a very small amount.
Ooh. Have you shown it? Have you shown this up close?
Yeah.
Like the nozzle part of it? Oh, this is actually completely see-through. Huh. That's cool. Yeah, if you look at the nozzle there, you can actually... you can see it come out of the tube. I don't like how it's got this rounded end at the end. Okay, what does it do?
It makes your skin less wrinkly, I guess.
It makes me prettier.
Yes.
That's what everything does. It just makes it prettier. It all just smells like plastic. I mean, I print a lot of plastic.
Oh, right.
So, yes, it smells like plastic. In my professional opinion, it smells like plastic. I like it. That's fancy. Yeah, for all the reasons before, Omar approved. So this is the Calming Moisture Repair Balm. Because I've got stuff on my fingers now from all the other sunscreen and the retinol or whatever else, it's kind of annoying to open, so it's very small. That small form factor, and with my bigger fingers, makes it annoying to open, so I don't really like that. That's right. The Omar review.
All of these products are available from Stylevana. You can use my discount code. Like and subscribe. Let me know what other products you want me to try out. More skincare videos are popping up around me. See you next time for more nerdy beauty science.